ברשות מורי ורבותיי, this lecture, this shiur, it's only for our friends that usually I prefer to speak in Hebrew or in French. In English, I have to fight with myself to explain myself in English, but that's, I will do my best that you will understand me. Baruch Hashem, we are with the permission of Rabbi Yaakov, which I just find out that he speaks well English. And we are now, in those days, to prepare ourselves for Matan Torah. We are all Jews, Yehudim, and we need, all of us, to prepare ourselves to receive this gift from Hashem. A gift, everyone knows what it is, a gift. A gift is a, like a man, a husband who gives to his wife a diamond ring, it's a gift. But this gift of the Torah is not a gift, because a Jew cannot live a life, a normal life. A Jewish normal life is start from the morning. You wake up, you run to the synagogue, you put tefillin, you want to eat, there is a bracha to do, not to talk lashon hara, to study Torah. A Jewish life is not easy. A Jewish life demands a lot of sacrifice. And this is the gift. Now, a wife, when she receives a gift from her husband, a beautiful diamond ring, she will appreciate it. She will be happy for a few weeks till he will have to buy her another one. But the Torah, to feel the gift of the Torah, it's not easy. The gift of the Torah is every second. At least the woman, the wife, when she receives this gift, she will be satisfied for maybe a few weeks, maybe 1 month, maybe 1 year, maybe 2 years. But the Torah, the gift of the Torah, is not a gift. It's not a pleasure of 1 minute. It's not a pleasure of 1 day or 2 days. It's every second. Every second you have to feel this beautiful gift that Hashem gives us. And for that, we need to start a preparation from Pesach. Hayav Adam le'arot et atzmo kilu yatzad Mitzrayim. Every Jew must have this sensation that he went out from Egypt. We don't know Egypt. We've never been in Egypt. We don't know what it is, Egypt. We know the story. But the Torah said, we read in the Haggadah, Hayav Adam le'arot et atzmo kilu hu yatza Mitzrayim. Every Jew must have feeling ki ilu yatza Mitzrayim. It's not easy. To feel that you were in Egypt, and to feel that you are out of Egypt, it's impossible. You've been in Iran, some of you. You left Iran. I was in Morocco. We left Morocco. We were Some people, they went to Israel, they left Israel. Pastor Shimon wanted to go back there. And then, I know everyone here, he was somewhere. Maybe there is few here that they born here, and they never went nowhere. But usually, most of us here, we belong to another place, and we came here. So, I know I come from Morocco. I know I come from France. I know I was in New York. I know I was in Canada. But to tell me, I never been to Africa. I never been to the jungle. And I will feel that I was in the jungle. I was in Africa. Impossible. I cannot have this feeling. It's like you tell a poor man, have a feeling that you are a rich man. It's impossible. You cannot have this feeling that he's a rich man. Tell a rich man, feel that you are a poor man. He will take your hat to Shalom. He will be afraid to hear that. No. You cannot tell somebody, somebody that is like Yom Kippur. I tell to somebody that he's hungry, he wants to eat, feel that you are eating a nice steak. It's impossible. It's not, there is no steak. Just you're under a plane, and you see the pilot, and tell the pilot, no, what about the plane who drives the plane? We tell you, feel you are the driver. You are the pilot. I'm not a pilot. How can you have this feeling that we went to Egypt and we left Egypt? The answer is Emunah. This is the answer. There is millions of answers. But one of an answer, this is Emunah. What it is Emunah? I believe. I believe in Hashem. And a man, do you see Hashem? Do you see Moshe Eliyahu Navi when there is a Brit Mila? Do you see Moshe Rabbeinu? No. Do you see Eliyahu Navi? No. When there is a Ilula for Bishma Bayahai. This is Emunah. The rabbi said you have to feel that you went to Egypt, so you have to feel it. But don't lie at yourself. You have to feel it. Don't lie. That means you have to feel it. But how? A man who has Emunah on HaKadosh Baruch Hu, he feels everything. I remember when I was a baby in Morocco, Rabbi Yaakov, best remember too. When we used to sit and to do the Haggadah with my father, and he used to stand up, and he used to take a plateau, a plate, and he used to put it, you know, around our head, and he used to say, "Bivilo Yatsa." That means that yes, we came out of Egypt with a quick, and he was happy, we were singing, and we felt, yeah. He was talking Arabic. Bibhilo Yatan Sayyim Alahmani Abnehoi. We are free people now, and we came out from Egypt, you know, so quick with the thanks, the help of Hashem. He was singing. He was singing, it's like he was living that he was out of Egypt. And then after the Birkat Hamazon, we used to say Shefor Hamat Halagoyim, we used to open the door and he used to say, "Hey, Baruch Haba Eliyahu." It's like we invite Eliyahu Nabi to come home. And he used to prepare him a glass of wine and he used to say, "This is the glass of wine of Eliyahu." And I remember one day I told my father, "Papa, did you see Eliyahu Nabi?" Because he was open the door and he was smiling and he was happy. He used to say, "Baruch Haba Eliyahu, Baruch Haba." So I was a baby. I said, "Papa, did you see him?" So he said, "And you, David, you saw him?" He said, "No, no, but you, because, we could see that he was looking at something, but he was looking at nothing. I mean, it's like I look to the wall. What do I see? Nothing. It's a wall. But it's like he was looking at something, but we saw nothing." And he said, "One day you grow, you will understand." So I got married. And then I follow the customs of my father. Then, when after we get Amazon, we open the door, shefor, and then I did what my father did. Baruch haba Eliyahu. Then Raphael, my son, he told me, Papa, did you see something? And I said, you are Raphael, do you have a picture to see? If you're Raphael, you saw something? Well, Raphael, when you grow, you will understand. Then, 2 years ago, or 3 years ago, we were all of us in Greece. And then, all the family was there. And then we arrived to Shefor. Raphael was married. His son, Haim. So all of us, we stand up, we open the door. Shefor, Baruch Haba Eliyahu. And I was looking, so everybody was singing, Shefor, Hamatra, then the story came back again. And Haim, he asked his father, Papa, tu l'as vu? Papa, right, did you see? And he looked at me, I looked at him, I told him, what? You know the answer. So he looked at me, Haim, when you grow, you will understand. So I have here 3 generations, when they grow, they will understand. Yeah. If I still doing that means I did understand. If after 64 years, I still open the door of my house and I welcome Eliyahu HaNavi to come home, which I see nothing, that means I did understand. That means maybe I don't see, but I see. Because if you want to see, you see. If you don't want to see, you can see, you don't see. It's up to you. You have to be crazy not to see. But it's so when we live in Emuna, so we saw nothing, we saw something. But we feel something. Rabotai, on Pesach, when I sing that I was in Egypt, thank you Hashem for leading me out of Egypt. I've been in Egypt, never in my life, but I've been there through the Torah. When you are convinced that the Torah is true, to live your life with the Torah. You live everything. You live everything. You live the Torah. You have a Brit Milah? You welcome Eliyahu? Have you seen Eliyahu? No. Yes. He's there. He's somewhere. The house. I don't know. Maybe I don't have the zikhu to say, but he's there. But I believe he's there. My friend, this is a kind of preparation that we prepare ourselves for Matan Torah. Matan Torah, it's not something easy. Matan Torah, it's a pleasure to feel Kip Shabbat. You feel when you put feeling. You have a pleasure to do mitzvot. When you live in the pleasure of being Jew. It's not easy to be Jew. Very difficult, very hard. You need a big sacrifice to feel your Judaism, to feel that you receive the Torah every second, and to enjoy your Torah, to enjoy your Judaism every minute. It's not easy. It's not easy. But it's up to our parents. The parents, the way they educate the children. I feel very bad this week for a family that unfortunately it's a complete broken family. The children are broken. All the family is finished. Why? Because they came from France and they came to Los Angeles. They came for one idea, to make money. That's it. They came because it's America. They thought they have a chance here. It's an American dream. And their dream come true. And then they have everything. When they left France, I know them. They had nothing, they only had religion. And suddenly, they came here, they came only for that. And because they came only for that, so they lost what the Judaism that they brought with them here, And now they have the race of the world. And now that all the children are not with Jewish, now the Jews started to wake up. They started to say, started to cry, ah, what happened? What happened? Now you cry, what happened? But if, I mean, you can come to America and to enjoy the American dream, to be rich, wealthy, and wear the wealth of the Torah with the mitzvot. Both of them. It's not a contradiction. You can live your life, money's life, and the Jewish life. But just with respect. But when you put the Jewish life one side, you think only about the American dream, it would be a big problem for the future. Our Judaism, it's not in danger. We make it in danger. I repeat. Our Judaism, Baruch Hashem, through thousands of years, never be in danger. Never. The Torah, she's here forever. There is no danger for the Torah. The one who is in danger is the man who is a Jew. He's a Jew. If he chooses to leave his Judaism, so he will have everything he needs. Otherwise, it could be a big problem. My friend, this is the preparation of Matan Torah. The preparation of Matan Torah to receive the gifts first. Do you know what it is, that kind of gift? It's not a 24-hour gift. It's not a gift that will forget it one day. It's not a gift that you have to change it. No. It's a gift that you have to feel it every second. You have to live it. You must have emunah at 24 hours a day. This week, I promise you, I don't have the age to tell you something that I don't feel it, that it's not true, God forbid. A lot of times, you know, I go to bed with questions, Torah questions. And when I go to bed, a lot of times, you know, I forgot to sleep. Have you heard somebody telling you he forgot to sleep? Yes, sometimes I forget to sleep. Because when I start writing the study, then the night goes quick. Then it's too late. That's it. You cannot go back to sleep. And a lot of times when I can't help myself, I have to go to sleep. And even in my sleep, I try to understand what I was learning, what I was studying before I went to sleep. And then I found answers. So I woke up because I'm excited for the answers. So what I do, not to forget them, I write them. And then is my night. This is the Torah. To enjoy the Torah. To love the Torah. I repeat again. The Torah, it's a gift. Every minute a gift. You feel it. This is the Torah. There is a... The Baal HaTani Alav HaShalom explained about there is something that we say the Haggadah, that of the Avodah Zarah, you know about it, that our parents, they were of the Avodah Zarah, they were, you know, idolatry. So the Baal HaTani Alav HaShalom asked a question, he said, what's this? Why we have to talk bad about our parents, that our parents, they were of the Avodah Zarah, that our parents, they were, I mean, on Pesach, we have to enjoy, we have to be happy. Baruch Hashem, we come out from Egypt. Okay, why we have to talk about our parents? That our parents, they were in Egypt, that they were of the Avodah Zarah, they were banned to idolatry, that he was a bad man. No, it's not. Okay, after he was a good man, but I don't need to tell you that my father was a bad man, my grandfather was a bad man. So why we have to talk about our grandfathers, that they were bad people? It's no good. And the Baal HaTani gave a beautiful answer. And I would like to explain you what he meant. As I said, to be Jew is very hard. But sometimes it's so hard. And I have a record, bad record, that I was not a good Jew in my life. And now it's like you listen. A lot of times when I talk, I see people, they look at me, and like I see through their face that they are living some moment of despair, they're desperate. Why? Because they're thinking, oh, what Rabbi David is telling now, it's good, but we live our life the opposite what he's telling. So it's impossible to be what he's telling us. Or it's impossible that one day Hashem will forgive all what we did. The answer is, you're wrong. You can be Haman, as we call it. You can be the biggest Rasha, the biggest man, bad man in the world. You can do teshuva. You can come back to Hashem. Don't disappear. That's why on Pesach we say, out there, I would ask, you about it, because on Pesach we're so happy. On Pesach we feel that we went to Egypt, there is Emuna, and then suddenly, what I did this year, would I feel Hashem tonight? Would Hashem will accept my Seder tonight? The answer is, yes. Even your parents, they were Rishaim before, and Hashem, he delivered them, he gave them the Torah. So if Hashem did that with your parents, he can do it with you. But this is what you should never be. Lowly change. Lowly change. This is the fight with the Yetzirah. All the inyan of the Yetzirah is to put you in a desespoir. You have no choice. Never can get something into something. You did so bad in your life. Hashem is far away from you. No, it's not true. It's not true. No. My friend, this is Shavuot. Shavuot, now we count the Omer. We count every day like somebody want to get married. So he counts days. And now we count days for our wedding, like a wedding with the Hashem, with the Torah, Shavuot. But you should know one thing. To reach that level of receiving the Torah, only if you feed Hashem on Pesach. If you feel that you were out of Egypt on Pesach, if you feel that, you receive the Torah. But if you don't feel that you are out of Egypt, so you are in Egypt. If you are still in Egypt, there is no Torah to receive. That's what we count, from Pesach to Shavuot, Omer. There is a connection, Pesach, Shavuot. Shavuot without Pesach, there is no Torah. Pesach without Shavuot, there is no Torah. I would like to tell you this. There is a beautiful story. I would like you to listen to this. There was a woman that she came with her husband when I was in Argentina. And they came because they have some problems, children problems. And she said to her husband, with your permission, can I start to talk? So the husband said, yeah, you have my permission. And she was talking to me, and every time she looked at her husband, and she asked the husband, it's okay? No objection, no. If I said something, I'm sorry. Then he said, no, it's okay, carry on. Then she talked, and after she asked the husband, now you can, maybe I said something wrong, maybe if I did, so you correct me, and now it's your turn to explain the rabbi our children problem. And then he looked at me, then he looked at her, and he told her, with your permission. She said, yeah. I saw, the first time in my life, I saw a couple talking like this way. I thought I was in a film. I thought I was doing it. Because usually people, a man and woman, they talk very open. No, no. pardon, permission. I never saw that in my life. So I was so excited. I told him, is this the way you talk in your house all the time? He said, yeah. This is how you talk? Yeah. This is how you talk. I said, madam, this is the first time in my life that I see a couple talking like that. How long have you been married? 35 years. 35 years you talk like that to your wife? I said, yes. You, madam, 35 years you talk like that. So there is no fight. No, 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 there is no fight in my house. And I started to think, please listen to this. I thought to myself, do we talk like that with Hashem? Hashem is the one that we should respect more than anything else. She's not, do we speak like that to our wives? Never. There is something that we have to learn. I promise you. You know what it is to love Hashem? It's not easy. The Kriyat Shema, we said, ואהבת את השם, אלוקיך, בכל לבבך ובכל נפשך, you must love Hashem with your heart, with your money, with your soul. Do we love Hashem באמת? Do we love Him? Do we have a proof that we love Him? Yes, we have to, yes, to love Hashem, but do we love Him? My friend, do I love my children? Of course I love them. I don't need to tell them I love you. I know I love them. But to Hashem, why I have to tell him I love you? The after, why? Have you seen a man 3 times or 5 times a day would tell to his wife, I love you? You are my heart, you are my soul. You are... No, no. Have you seen a man talking to his children and telling them, I love you? You are my heart. You are... No. Why do I have to do this to Hashem? Why do HaKadosh Baruch Hu have to do this kind of declaration in Kriyat Shema? They have tied Hashem. You know why? Because the Yetzirah will not let you love Hashem. The Yetzirah is afraid. He don't want to lose a customer. He don't want to lose you. He will do everything. To tell Hashem I love you, we don't love him. She says, but when we have Torah, the Torah teaches you how to love Hashem. There is rules. How I know that I love Hashem, you know how? I pray. I put tefillin. I respect Shabbat. That is my declaration. So, even with that, it's not enough. I have to tell him I love him. That is like a compromise. I compromise myself in the morning. Yes, I love Hashem. Because after I leave the shul, the synagogue, the Yetzirah will start to beat me again. So, with this declaration, that will put me in a position that really I love Hashem. So, my friend, if with all this declaration, so of course, on Pesach, when we come to Pesach, we know what it is Pesach about. Pesach is to declare to Hashem, thank you, next. Thank you, HaKadosh Baruch Hu, for all what you did for me. So of course, I know the history. So when I sit around the Seder, and I said, yes, and I start the Seder, I must feel. It's automatic. I mean, if I am sitting in the table with my children and my wife, I know this is my wife, I know this is my mother, I know this is my father, I know this is my children. I know. No, I don't need to ask them, hey, who are you? Hey, I will ask my wife, hey, madam, who are you? No, because this is my family. I have to feel Hashem apart, like my family. Hashem is here as well. Yes. I know why I'm sitting here. I know what's going to happen this tonight, the Seder. I know. So you know. Yes, I know. The same way I know who is sitting around me at the table, I know what everything is about. I know. So if I know, I know the rest. What is the rest? This Pesach is a preparation for Shavuot, for Matan Torah. That Hashem wants us to understand that our life, our tachlis, is there. Hashem wants us to know that all our compromise to Him is to receive the Torah. And then, Be'ezat Hashem, to feel the pleasure of the Torah, to feel the pleasure of Judaism. I would like to tell you what happened in France a few weeks ago. Of course, of all of you, you heard what happened to Hyper Kasher. That man that killed some Jews only because they were Jews. And they unfortunately, for the four of them, I know them. One of them, he used to come to the yeshiva in Paris. He has a beautiful voice. He used to do the chazan on Shabbat, Mincha. I know all of them. When he went there to buy a bottle of wine for Shabbat. Another one, he went there to buy halot. There, a man that used to come, that he comes, still comes, every day, half day, he studies it for a half day. And unfortunately, he went there to buy for Shabbat. So he was among the hostage. And he was with his wife, and every second he felt that he used to look at him, the terrorist, used to tell him, when after I pray, I will start with you. So he knew he's gonna die. When he did the Seuda, Baruch Hashem, he did not die, Baruch Hashem, and he did the Seuda Todaya, he told us this. Look, listen what he said. He said, no one can understand how much I felt close to Hashem on those moments. He said, no one can understand. We all feel we are close to Hashem, but only, he said, even in Yom Kippur, even if I take all my life, I never felt 1 second close to Hashem like those hours that I was waiting for this man just to look at me and to shoot me. I felt every moment Hashem. So I told him, please tell me what you felt. Teach me. He said, Rabbi David, I cannot explain to you. It's something that I cannot explain to you. But he looked at me, he said, now that I come back again to study Torah like before, I feel what I felt that Friday there. That means the pleasure of when you sit, study Torah, you do mitzvot, you do that for Hashem, so Hashem is next to you. One question I would like to ask you. Do you love Hashem?
Yes.
Yes, of course. There will be no one here to tell me a doubt, or I don't know. But as I told you, to love Hashem is not only by the mouth. Yes, Hashem wants actions. He wants to see you. He wants your declaration. And he wants the result. You know, for me, when you have to do your test of your blood, if you are diabetic, or so they take blood, they send it to the laboratory, and they test it. Then you receive the result, yes, no. For me, the laboratory of every Jew to see if we love Hashem or not, starts, they check yourself on Pesach. It's on Pesach that we check ourselves. How much emunah we have in Hashem? Do we feel Hashem? Do we feel that we are out of Egypt and now we are going to receive the Torah? Do we feel that? This is the test. How does it start on Pesach? And Baruch Hashem, we have this opportunity. Baruch Hashem, thanks God that Hashem give us this beautiful moment to feel HaKadosh Baruch Hu on Pesach. Only through preparations to the Seder, and they will ask you, hey, do you feel that you are out of Egypt? Then your answer will be yes or no. If you say no, too bad. You say yes, I'll ask you how. So you will, the answer is, will be, well, the reason why I am out of Egypt, to receive the Torah. Egypt, it could be every day, every second. When you leave your home to go for a lecture or to go pray, this is Yetziat Mitzrayim. You went out of your own Egypt, because every second the Yetzirah want to put you in Egypt. Every moment the Yetzirah want to put you in the camp of Egypt. Talk to you. There was a woman who came to see me crying, and she put a picture on the table. She said, Rabbi, why I suffer? Now, there is a picture that all her life, all her family life, it's that picture. Look, Rabbi, all my family are here. Look how happy we were. And they left. This one is married to a Goya, this one, I have no news from them, only 3 years. And I told her, this picture was taken on Pesach, yes? She was shocked. She said, how do you know? How do you know? Do you see? Yes, but how do you know? How do you know? Because I see the matzot in the picture. Because I see the wine. I see the kahara. The plate, you know, that special plate. I'm not a prophet, I see it. You know. Even you forgot to tell it's Pesach. So she said, you see, Rabbi, we did Pesach, we were together. So why they left me? I said, madam, Look well at the picture. The reason it's in the picture. So she started to look at the picture. She said, Rabbi, I can only see the picture that we were happy family. There is no reason why they left the Judaism. What do you see? For this picture you see, there is matzot. Madam, you are blind. There is two kinds of blind people. The Misilat Yisrael explained, there is a kind of people that they are blind because they were born blind, and there is another kind of blind people that they want to become blind. They see, but they don't want to see. It's like somebody who walks the other side of the street, he knows there is a synagogue, and he will not enter the synagogue to pray. And then we ask him, hey, Jesus, I did not know. But we did the Torah. You didn't want to see, that's it. There was a Brit Milah. I was a Sandak. There was a man that he was surprised to see me, that I was the Sandak. And that man, he's from Los Angeles. He was very poor. And I remember he came to ask me about something. an advice, and I give him an advice 25 years ago. And then, Baruch Hashem, the advice was good, and they become rich. And now, but since he became rich, he forgot. Never seen him. Never saw him again. And then I was the Sandak, who was next to the door. Now we had a problem. He did not know how to work out, because he thought that I will recognize him, and I will tell him, hey, you forgot? Now that you have money, you forgot. So he laughed at the Brit Mila people, they shake my hand. I was shaking the hands of everybody, but I was looking at him. I didn't want to miss him. I wanted to see what he's going to do. And then he had no choice. And we were left in the synagogue only, still sitting on the chair, and he was sitting in the back of the synagogue. He would not walk out, and I would not stand to walk out from the synagogue. I was waiting for him. Then he has no choice. He had to walk out. Then I looked at him. I was looking at him when he was walking. And then he came. He said, yes? He forgot me. Now I was thinking, so he started to talk to me in French. I was thinking, are you Rabbi David Pinto? I told him, I didn't mock. I am Rabbi David Pinto. You forgot you had nothing. You forgot the advice I give you. Don't tell me you forgot me. Why did I change in 5 years? Why did I become a monster in 5 years? The same way that you remain the same, I am the same. Maybe some gray hair, but the face is the same face. Just then after he said, I'm sorry. You see? You know, we all know Hashem. Don't tell me we don't know Him. We all know Him. We act like this blind man that is not blind. He wants to make himself blind. That's it. After 120 years, when we face Hashem, He will recognize us, and we will recognize Him. Then He will tell us, well, can we tell Him, forgot your face, forgot you? I didn't do that. Because Hashem, it will clear our mind, it will be clear at 100%, at one point that we cannot say to Him, I don't know you. Because we all know Him. Because all our life there is a moment that we say, thanks God. Be'ezat Hashem. Always, one moment in our life, we have something, a emunah that came. You see, and at the end, the car will go on his own. See, it's enough to push him a little bit. How much time Hashem will push us? Then we start running, but we stop. Break. We break. Again, Hashem. He start pushing us a little bit. And then we stop. It's not his fault, it's our fault. So that woman, I told her, madam, look at where the picture. She looked at the picture. She said, Rabbi David, please, tell me what wrong you see this picture. I said, look, they are watching a football game. Look at the picture. All they turn their back to the Seder table. They are watching a football game. This is Pesach. Look at the television. So Pesach on one hand, football game on one hand. So what this family had in their hand at the end, only the football game. It was not Pesach. It was not the Seder of Pesach. You see, Rabotai, everyone here of us, he has a story, his own story. But never mind. We have to leave everything behind. As the Baal Tanya said, don't despair. You can go ahead. You can start. If you want now, you can start now. No problem. You know what I do? A lot of times, this is something I'm not ashamed to tell you this. I was in New York a month ago, and I arrived to Paris, and I was very tired. And I did not know what to do, to go home, to sleep, or to go to the yeshiva, to pray. At the end I said, look, tonight is Friday, it's Erev Shabbat, I will sleep tonight. Now I go to the yeshiva. I was at the yeshiva, but I had a problem. I did not have the tefillin of Rabbi Nutam. Because the tefillin of Rabbi Nutam, they were in the house. So I prayed, and I went home. And on Friday, usually on Friday, I help my wife. To which I give you an advice, you must help your wife on Friday. Like Shabbat, it's not only, it's Shabbat for all of us, so it's good, it's a mitzvah to, on Shabbat, it's a big mitzvah to help the wife. Lichvot Shabbat, so usually that's what I do. And then I forgot to put, because I put two tefillin, Rashi Rabbi Nutam. So Rashi, I put in the morning, Rabbi Nutam, I forgot. Then, it was, I think, 1 week before Pesach. And the daily gom was kosher for Pesach. So we had to eat in the kitchen. And so the daily gom was closed. And I said to my daughter, Ariel, I want to light the Shabbos candles on the dining room. So she said, but Papa, I prepare them on the kitchen because we don't eat there. I said, no, I want to light them there. I light them there, then I bring them to the kitchen. And that was about 5 minutes before Shabbat. Okay? So she said, okay, Papa, if you want it. Okay. So I went to the dining room to light the Shabbat candles, and I saw the tefillin of Rabbi Nutam on the table. And I remember I did not put them in. So I had to put them quick, 5 minutes before Shabbat. You see, what do I learn from that story that I tell you? The problem, a Jewish problem, is this. The Tzara, he will do everything that everything in his power just to make you forget to do the mitzvot. Even if you like them, you will do everything that you will forget them. That's what the Pekah Avot said, mitzvah haba'a bi'adecha atach mitzina. When there is a mitzvah that comes to your hand, don't miss it. If you miss it, you will forget. I mean, there is a mitzvah, do it. Don't say, derche efne eshne. I will have time, I'll do it. No, maybe you will now, do it now. Don't miss it. I promise you, this is a Jewish life. There is a mitzvah to do, do it. Only those mitzvah that Hashem bring us, that it came to our hands, maybe this mitzvah will protect you, who knows? If this mitzvah comes to your hand, maybe Hashem has a reason why this mitzvah comes to your hand. You don't know, but maybe Hashem, he knows. So I learned that first, when I came from New York to Paris, I should have put tefillin of Rabbi Nutam right away when I came home. Why I did wait? Because I waited, so nearly I forgot to put them. Imagine if Shabbat will come and I will remember I did not put them, how much I will be in pain. How much every one of us here, yes, must live in Judaism. We have happy professor to be Jew, but it's not enough. Not only to be Jew, you have to feel it. You know, in France today, a lot of times, Bemet, I'm telling you, a lot of times in France, you know, on Friday, on Shabbat, I have to walk from the house to the synagogue. There is sometimes that there is too much anti-Semite, and you can see the eyes of those people who look at you, and they make you embarrassed by with their eyes, and you feel ugly, you feel, who I am? I am a dog, I am a monkey, why do you have to watch me like this? But in my heart, well, I belong to the chosen people. This is my answer. You can only hate somebody that is good. You can only be jealous for something that you don't have. Oh Hashem, I have the Torah. Hashem loves me. I love him. And I go to shul. So, this is the way. This is the way of sacrifice. This is the price to pay being Jew. Here, you, Jewish people, we live in America, you have another kind of nisyonot, of test. That here in America you have everything. There is too much gashmius, too much material. Here we talk only like this proverb, time is money. This is an American dream. This is the Nisayon. Maybe in France the Nisayon to be Jew is because of too much anti-Semite. Here, the kind of test that you have here is material. Material is good. I don't say it's not good. It's beautiful. It's good to be rich. It's good to have everything you need. Just don't forget Hashem. Don't forget it. Just have always Hashem in your mind. When you say to Hashem, I love you, you have to love him. Not just with the mouth. I remember there was a woman, a couple who came, they wanted a divorce. And the woman, she said to the husband, yes, he never declared, no declaration that he liked me. When I have a nice dress, he never tell me a nice word, always you are ugly, always now I am ugly, I want to divorce. Because people find me I'm beautiful. Why only my husband find that I am ugly? So he told her, no, my dear, you're beautiful. Yes, because I want to divorce you, yeah. Now I am. So I told him, why are you bad with your wife like this? He said, well, if I tell her that she's pretty, she will ask me to buy her. So I have to pay. I have to pay more because I said this. I probably not to say nothing. So now you must tell her. Give him this cost of money. You have to tell her. Give her this. You must give her the sensation that she feels that she's married to somebody, not she's married to a stranger. We have to feel that Hashem is our God, not to feel that Hashem is a stranger. The same way that Hashem will wake you up in the morning, He's with you, He takes care of you. Yeah, well, thank you. My friend, I wish you, to all of you, Bracha v'atzlacha, good v'at Hashem. I pray for you that Hashem give you parnasa tova. And I pray to Hashem to give you happiness, health, good mazal, good zivuk in Eratzon, and be'ezrat Hashem, we pray to Hashem to see Mashiach Tzidkenu, be'ezrat Hashem, and to see Eretz Yisrael, be'ezrat Hashem, that Hashem protect our land of Eretz Yisrael, and the Eratzon that HaKadosh Baruch Hu bring the peace to the world in Eratzon. Good parnasa, and we wish to Rabbi Yaakov, my brother, and to all of you, can you stand up, please? Mishgach Avodeinu Avraham Yitzchak Yaakov Moshe Aaron David Shlomo. יברך את כל הקהל הקדוש הזה, גדודים ופתלים, הם ובניהם, ושהם תלמידים ומשרים. מלכת יעלמה, יביא ברך התכון.
אמן.
יזכי התכון.
אמן.
ישמע אבקה סותכון.
אמן.
יזבק כול כוסה והקטרם את אדוני בסעדכם.
אמן.
יגיע בעדכם.
אמן.
יפות שכל שימו עליכם.
אמן.
ביתה ביניכם אהבה ואהבה שלום רעות.
אמן.
שדה קצין החינה ביניכם.
אמן.
ומדי צרותיכם. וישלח לך בקדוש ברוך הוא רפואה שלמה.
אמן.
בקדוש ברוך הוא פרנסה טובה.
אמן.
מלא עליכם ורחמים וכן לרצון ולומר אמן.
אמן.
שהשם יתלהב, מהשם יביאו פרנסה טובה, ברכה והשמחה, כל מעשיכם.
נזרתו על הרבה חיים פינתו וקפלנה זה